Good afternoon, everybody. We're here from New Jersey. My name is Charlie Wowkanech from the New Jersey State AFL-CIO. And for some time in our state, there was discussion about legalizing recreational marijuana. We legalized medical marijuana first, but we got into the discussion of the recreational marijuana. And when we really got serious about it, we thought that the industry could really bring forth a lot of jobs. So we set out with many of our union candidates, I should say, who are elected to public office in our state assembly and state senate. And we also have the sponsor of the legislation, Steve Sweeney, our senate president. Steve, stand up. Take a bow. Who introduced the legislation. We decided to do something a little bit different than other states. We saw what happened in Massachusetts, where the big corporate, I guess, cannabis operators came in and took over. So we designed a piece of legislation in New Jersey that provided pro-labor provisions, which would help, working with the UFCW, I should say, and the legislature. We developed these pro-labor provisions that would help let us organize, make organizing more easier. We also, there was a great appetite from the legislature to also design into it a social justice component. So a certain percentages of the licenses for the retail centers were going to minority-operated businesses that lived in the towns, as well as we reformed the criminal justice system for some of those people that had been previously convicted, young man, young woman, maybe smoking a joint, now it's on his record. So this piece of legislation was probably one of the most, is the strongest language in the country. On the labor side, we have provisions like labor peace agreements, project labor agreements. You need to sign these things, these documents, to apply for a temporary license. You have to first qualify to get a temporary license. Once you get a temporary license on the labor side, then you have, and you've signed a labor peace agreement, then you have approximately 200 days to sign a collective bargaining agreement or you lose your license. So it's a pretty powerful tool. And what this has evolved, and you'll hear from the director of organizing for United Food and Commercials Local 360 here, how a lot of the operators, when they saw the law and knew they had to have these requirements signed, they started to call us instead of us going out to organize them. And I've got to give a great hand to you and his team for the job that they've done. We envision possibly within the next 3 to 4 years, 100,000 new union members in this industry. And we call this seed to sale. So we have the farmers, growers, truck drivers, the whole operation that is dealt with the sale of cannabis in our state is covered under this piece of legislation. So at this time, I'd like to introduce you. He's like the Energizer Bunny. I can't believe from the north to the south to the east to the west, he's all over the place. I think probably 50% of the places are already organized and have a first contract, which is very, very unusual, as you know, in a new emerging industry. So at this time, I'd like to introduce my brother, my friend, Hugh Giordano. Hugh?
Thank you. Thank you. Yes. So my name is Hugh Giordano, and I am the director of organizing for UFCW Local 360. Before I begin, I do want to recognize these workers here. I have Carlos Paul, who is one of our members at Columbia Care Dispensary, and Janet Rose, who's one of our members at the Botanist Dispensary in New Jersey. And they are both newly organized employers, and these are both the folks who made it happen. So before we go, please a round of applause. This is direct organizing right here. So it's been a long, long road. The UFCW has been working on cannabis for over a decade in New Jersey and almost two decades in the U.S. and along with Canada as well. We've put a lot of man hours, a lot of money into this campaign, but it was for good reasons. When cannabis was first legalized in the West, specifically in the medical market in California, these facilities were legal under the state law, but under the federal law, it was a no-no. So these facilities were getting raided. Medical facilities, dispensaries, cultivation sites, and as a labor union, we saw it was a major problem. When you see workers on the cover of USA Today working in a legal job in zip ties because they're being arrested for distribution of an illegal narcotic under the federal law, there was nobody there to protect them. There was nobody. Lawyers wouldn't touch it with a 10-foot pole. Politicians wouldn't even talk about it. Very few, you would have, consider the fringe candidates that would talk about cannabis and legalization. So we were one of the first major bodies in the country to step up to the plate and say, these workers matter. They're professionals. They deserve to be respected like any other job in this country. And that's why we're proud to say that all the hard work, finally, New Jersey has some of the best labor standards in the country. Now, in saying that, you know, what did we do? You know, it began with talking to politicians. It began with doing the groundwork on the local level as well, talking to city council and mayors and getting local labor standards passed on the local level so that when they applied for a license, they had to sign a labor peace agreement and a project labor agreement. We worked directly with the building trades to make sure that it was a shovel-to-sale agreement, not just seed-to-sale. So when we are talking to our employers around the country, we're not only pressing for our labor peace agreement, but I am making sure personally that in New Jersey that we sign project labor agreements every single time because it has to be done. One of the things that I do stress too, as part of this bill was about economic justice, social justice. Okay, restorative justice, specifically in cities and towns that have been persecuted on the war of drugs, mostly people of color, those that mostly African American, middle class and poor people they attacked, and immigrants. So it was a workers' rights issue from day one. Also, patients' rights was something that we did. We worked directly with patient advocacy groups because patient rights and workers' rights are the same conversation. So we made this from day one. We made coalitions immediately, whether it was the ACLU, the NAACP. This was a conversation that had to be done. And when it came to ballot initiatives to legalize cannabis, UFCW put not only groups, bodies on the ground to knock on doors, but we put money in the coffers to make sure that this bill was passed because we knew what it would equal. It would equal good jobs. It would equal middle-class opportunities for people that would have never had that before. Healthcare, retirement plans. These workers are professionals. No different than a pharmacy tech. No different than a pharmacist or a chemist. These folks are highly educated. They understand. And on top of that, they're dealing with people, especially in New Jersey, just recently was the adult use market. These workers were talking to people with stage 4 cancer, you know, people that have MS, end of life scenario, and it was treated and it still is treated as medicine. And that's one of the things that I kind of want to make it clear. This is not, you know, what you see on TV. These are not pot shops that people are just hanging out smoking all day. These are legit regular jobs, careers. Their careers. So, in saying that, I want to turn my attention to the workers. One of the things that's benefited us big is the labor peace agreement. And Janet was one of our lead workers at a dispensary, and we used the labor peace requirement to make sure that her and her co-workers could organize. A little bit about that, Janet, what are some things that as a worker that was important to you to form and join a union? What are some, you know, basic everyday workers' issues that you thought a union could help with?
I think obviously one of the first things for me being on the front lines of it was pay. We're not paid for what we're doing on a daily basis. You kind of touched on it, you know, we're a sounding board for a lot of people. We act as an alternative treatment center. So we're offering like pharmaceutical aid to a lot of people that are coming in. You know, there's a lot that's involved. There's a lot that goes into it. So I think for me, pay was one thing. Security was another thing. We want to feel safe when we're on the job. We want to be protected. We want to be heard. Medical benefits are another thing. Good time off. You know, there was a need. There's a gap and a need that needs to be filled. And I wanted to voice my opinion to pull some of those things together.
That's great. That's great. Now, Carlos now worked for a company that would not recognize labor peace. And those are some of the issues that we're still working on and solidifying to strengthen labor peace language. You know, one of the things that's very clear with it right now is that if you don't recognize labor peace, we could theoretically strip their license from them. But as a labor union, we didn't want to do that because patients, you know, rely on this medicine. So we have to find ways to make it so that when we organize workers, that Carlos doesn't have to go through those issues of a company ignoring the law and skirting the law. And Carlos, what are some of the issues that you ran into when you were trying to organize? What were some of the tactics the company used?
One of the things that they tried doing was anti-union meetings every morning. They would call them morning boosters. They would tell us how the union can't do anything for us, they're not going to protect us, they won't be able to actually help us to make this a career, that if we stay with our company and not go with the union, that it would be a lot more beneficial for us in the long run. They also tried threatening everyone who was on like the major board of the committee to try to get the union started. They would pull them in the office. They would try to keep them very like hush-hush. They wanted to stop it really before it started. With that came write-ups. You know, they said disciplinary action. They were going to try to terminate a few of us. When we started getting new hires, you know, they said that they needed more people because if we did a vote, we don't have enough people right now. It wouldn't be fair to the new people coming in. As new people came in, they would try to separate them from all of the old workers, and they would tell them a bunch of anti-union propaganda, telling them that the union's just going to take their money, that we're going to try to force them, that basically we're holding a gun to their head and saying that you have to choose the union or the job. So it was just a lot of them trying to stop us and fight us and basically threaten not just our jobs, but our jobs are our livelihood, and this is more than a job.
So we still have a little bit of work, but there are some other great things in our law that we are going to fight for across the country as well. And one of the things that we have in this law, because of the Senate President Sweeney, was the 200-day collective bargaining agreement proposal. So after we organize, the company has 200 days to then bargain a collective bargaining agreement. And if they don't, in good faith, they can lose their license. So it puts pressure on the company to have to sit down and negotiate in good faith. We're one of the few states that have that law in the country. On top of that, I think the one thing that's very important to recognize is that most companies that we're dealing with right now understand that we are the force behind making things happen. We're on the ground everywhere, and it gives us an opportunity to make relationships. That's the one thing we've been trying to do, is make partnerships with companies to show it that labor and industry can get together and work together. And in doing that, we have, like any other industry association, we have a cannabis industry association in New Jersey. And what we did was we partnered with them immediately. And the industry association, not only did they not fight our labor peace agreement language, but they actually endorsed it at a few sessions openly, because they saw that we were helping their members as well, their corporate members, making sure they got approved for a license on the local and the state level. So the great thing about this is that labor peace has opened the door for conversation. Unlike other industries where they walk in ready to fight you day one, we're able to now have these conversations and have long-term national relationships. So right now, you know, both Janet and Carlos are on the negotiating teams for their prospective dispensaries. Would you say that things are starting, that the companies now are recognizing you more, even though your contract's not done yet, that you feel like they're more open to having a conversation with you because they're being somewhat watched at this point? Or, you know, that you feel that your voices are being heard a little bit more?
I don't know that I feel like our voices are being heard more at work, but I think they're paying attention to us more. You know, I know specifically where I'm at, my dispensary, my management team, not that they're open to having these conversations right now, but they're engaging in a way that they weren't engaging before. And I think that's because they know that we're heading into these negotiations. So there's more of a presence, actually, in the dispensary right now.
Okay. You know, if we look, I would ask everybody to definitely grab a flyer if you haven't gotten one. Because, you know, these are, no matter what industry you're in, I think that a lot of these tactics and stances can be used to protect workers in all industries. Social equity and economic justice, workers' rights have to be the same conversation. You know, LGBTQ rights, immigrant rights, all these folks are in this cannabis workplace. And I think the great thing about it is we have natural leaders. You know, Carlos stood up against a $1 billion company every single day, stood up for him, himself, and his colleagues. You know, these workers are professionals, and we want to make sure that they stay heard. You know, the UFCW is committed to continuously put our resources out there as to make sure that labor peace requirements are part of not only New Jersey state law, but hopefully nationally at some point, right? That's the goal. Shoot for the stars. We know it's a long road ahead. But, you know, besides the dispensary side, one of the things that's important is we've talked about this as, you know, just as unionists, the PRO Act. You know, cannabis workers, are, especially in the cultivation side, are considered agriculture workers. So unless there's labor peace requirements on the state level, they will say that these workers in the cultivation sites are ag workers, and they won't have the right to organize. And that's why labor peace requirements are so important. And that's why the PRO Act is so important. So that we can make sure that not only cultivation workers in ag are protected, but because of cannabis and the technology, indoor grows are becoming bigger and bigger for vegetables and fruits now. You see 150,000 square foot indoor grows. That technology came from these trained professionals in cannabis, the botanists and the horticulturists that have been working in these indoor vertical facilities. And, you know, so it's bigger than just that. And these cannabis workers, from seed to sale, are leading the fight for other industries as well. So that's, you know, that's one of the things that we've been really concerned about. The other thing is making sure labor peace requirements in cannabis show how the PRO Act would work. You know, having a majority plus one to organize. And that's what the labor peace agreement is. So it shows that the PRO Act would be beneficial to not only cannabis workers, but to all workers. And we're hoping that these great people here will lead the way for workers around the country. So, that's really what I got.
Anybody have any questions?
Any questions? Anything?
Any questions?
No, I don't have any free samples right now. But we can always hotbox later. Yes. Sure. So one of the things, if I guess I'll just stand up. So the question was, how have we engaged with the construction side? Because I said shovel to sale. Well, economic justice and social justice have been the big key elements of the governor's office, the Senate, and the Assembly. So what we have said is that the construction side is part of that conversation. How many women do we see at construction sites? How many people of color do we see at construction sites? And I make it very clear that when you do walk by a site usually and it has immigrants, they're using and abusing those workers. They are not treating them fairly. They don't have hard hats on. They don't have boots. So by using trades labor, you are doing everything that the state espouses on day one, even before you cut the ribbon. And I always talk about how the building trades are looking to do pre-apprenticeship programs, making sure that young women get involved in the high schools, making sure that people of color get involved. That's social justice. Giving people an opportunity to learn a trade, specifically in impact zones, in zones where people are living, not even living paycheck to paycheck, they're beneath that economically. It gives people an opportunity to change their entire lives. And I tell them that it's great press. And that's what these companies want. They want to be seen and heard. So anything positive that we can do and give to them, they run with it. The building trades definitely has some.
The other part of her question was, how did we implement that? So when these companies apply to the state of New Jersey for a temporary license, because you have to have a temporary license first, there's a ranking. If you have a PLA agreement, you have to sign a labor peace agreement. But all these pro-labor provisions that we put in here give you a ranking. So what we've seen is, obviously, the companies want to get in business and start selling cannabis right away. So rather than fight us, they actually call you and say, what do we have to do to get the license? We've worked in our office at the State Fed with some of the vendors, helping them fill out the license, getting these agreements signed so that they're favorable. Then once they get the temporary license, and as you said, and the workers go through an election, from that point on, they got 200 days to enter into a collective bargaining agreement, or they could lose their license. So, you know, that's how the construction side got in there. That's it. That's a wrap, I guess, huh?
That's it.
There's more brochures here that really describe the law and what we did for anybody who wants to pick it up and take a copy home. Thank you very much.